गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे आवर टॉपिक इज़ कंप्यूटर हार्डवेयर एंड इन दिस लेक्चर वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस सम मेमोरीज, स्पेशली सेकेंडरी मेमोरीज. इन अवर लास्ट लेक्चर वी ऑलरेडी डिस्कस प्राइमरी मेमोरी. सो लेट्स स्टार्ट फॉर बिफोर स्टार्टिंग द न्यू टॉपिक लेट्स टेक अ रिविजन ऑफ प्रीवियस लेक्चर. सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल एज यू नो द व्हाट इज कंप्यूटर. Computer is an electronic device that can perform three main types of operation. First one is mathematical operation, second is logical operation, and third is graphical operation. So these three types of operation can be performed using a computer. And then this is a block diagram of computer. You can easily see that. Always remember this diagram and draw a diagram again on a copy until and unless you feel comfortable to draw this diagram without any help. So there are four different parts of it. That's why it's called the block diagram of computer system, and all these parts are represented within a block according to the definition of block diagram and connected using an arrow sign. So there are four different parts of it: input device, output device, secondary storage, and CPU. We already discussed CPU and primary memory, but today our topic is secondary storage. So let us take a quick revision of this. As far as the CPU is concerned, CPU basically have three important part: control unit, arithmetic logic unit, and register. Whenever block diagram of CPU is asked in your examination, just draw this diagram and explain it. So there are three different parts of a CPU: control unit, which control the entire operation within the CPU; arithmetic and logical unit, which perform arithmetic and logical operation. Arithmetic operations include addition, subtraction, multiplication, division. These are the arithmetic operation. And as far as the logical operations concerned, these are related to less than, greater than, less than equal to, greater than equal to, or equal to. These all are the logical operation where we compare more than two or more than two numbers. And third part is register. Register is the smallest memory, is a part of the CPU. We can easily see that register plays here, and basically it stores the intermediate and the final result or the value of the variable inside the CPU. This is RAM. Actually, this is a random access memory here. This is secondary memory directly connected to control unit. This is input and output unit. In fact, each and every part of a computer is directly connected to control unit, because control unit work is to send the signal, control signal, to different unit and check the functionality of the different parts of a computer, whether they are performed well or not. So we can see that control unit connected to each and every part of a computer, or in this diagram especially, each and every part of this CPU. We can easily see that. And outside the CPU, it is already connected to input unit, output unit, and secondary storage or secondary memory. These are the components of a CPU. So always remember that this is the diagram of the block diagram of a CPU, and it is already explained in our previous lectures, but just revise it again and draw the diagram again until it is very much clear to all of you. Then register. So today's our topic is register, and the different types of memory is a part of chapter second, computer hardware. So register is already discussed. So what is registers? A register is a temporary storage. It is the smallest memory, it is the fastest memory, it is a part of CPU, and it is a temporary memory also. And sometimes it is also called the processor register, and its size is too small that size is considered to you in bytes, bits, 8-bit, 16-bit, 32-bits, or 64-bits. So 32-bit and 64-bits are more common in size. And as we know that 8-bit is equal to 1 byte. So bit can also be converted to byte. Next is arithmetic and logical operator. So arithmetic and logical operators basically perform arithmetic and logical operations regarding to the computer systems. Arithmetic operations include addition, subtraction, multiplication, division. These are the arithmetic operations, and logical operations involve basically comparisons such as less than, greater than, less than equal to, or greater than equal to. So these all are the arithmetic and logical operators. So basically arithmetic and logical unit performs different types of arithmetic and logical operations within a computer system. So all the arithmetic and logical parts, all the arithmetic and logical types of calculation is done by arithmetic and logical unit, and sometimes it is also called as ALU. It means arithmetic and logical unit. Next is control init. As the name suggests, control init, it control entire operations within the computer systems. Basically, it send different signal, control signal to different parts of a CPU, which basically used to show the functionality of the or check the functionality that whether a particular input or output devices works works properly or not, or whether they are connected or not, or is the or also in the case of memory, it check whether operation is right or whether memory is ready to receive the data or just write to the data. So these types, all these types of instructions are called the control instructions or control signals. So control signal are sent by a control init to check the functionality that the all the devices are properly connected or behave properly or not. So these all types of operation are done by control init. As the name suggests, always remember that control init, name says that control init means control the entire operation within the computer systems. Next, there is a comparison between CPU and ALU. I think all of you are very familiar to all of these terms, CPU and ALU. Basically, ALU is a part of the CPU. CPU consists of three parts, as the diagram shown in, as we shown in the diagram just now. So CPU have three parts, ALU, CU, and register. ALU is one of them. So as far as difference is concerned, you can write within a single line that ALU is a part of CPU. And now, so these are all the topics which we discussed in our previous lectures. So here I give you a quick revision of all these terminologies. If you want to know them more, then just go to that video and where these topics are discussed and just learn it. And second is chapter 2, types of hardware. So types of hardware, this chapter starts from the with the topic types of computers here, and there are different types of computer here. We can easily see that as far as the classification is concerned. First of all, types of computer, computer can be divided into two basic parts according to the purpose wise or according to the principles of operations. So according to the purpose wise, computer can be divided again into two parts, special purpose computers and general purpose computers. Special purpose computers are those computers which perform specific tasks only, and general purpose computer can perform a variety of tasks depending on the program given. Next, again on the basis of the principles of operations, computer can again divide it in three different types: analog computer, digital computer, and hybrid computers. So what analog computer, basically the analog computer work on continuous physical quantities such as voltage, current, temperature, etc., and they take input in the form of volts, ampere, and Celsius, not in the forms of 0 and 1, in the forms of physical quantities. These all are the physical quantities. So analog computer take input in the forms of physical quantities such as volts, ampere, Celsius, etc. And second is digital computer. As we know that work with the digital data. Digital data means discontinuous data, that is 0 or 1. So receive the data in forms of 0 and 1 only. So that's why they are called the digital computers, and they are most common type of the computer nowadays. Third is hybrid computer. Basically, as the name suggests, it is a combination of both the analog and the digital computer. So that's why they are called the hybrid computers. Next, classification of digital computer again can be divided into different parts, and so many number of times it is asked in the examination that write the different types of digital computers. So these are the different types of computers. So there are two important questions regarding to this chart. First of all, what is the difference between analog and digital computers? So as far as this difference between analog and digital computer is concerned, you can easily say that analog computer works on the physical quantities. They receive the data in the forms of physical quantities such as volts, ampere, and Celsius, and digital computer, those computer which work on 0 and 1, or we can say that digital data or discontinuous data also. So and hybrid computer, as the name suggests, it is basically the combination of analog and digital computer, nothing special in it. So in some application ways related to, suppose weather forecasting is an example of hybrid computer, which use analog and digital data both. Next, digital classification of digital computers. Now again, classification of digital computer is concerned, personal or desktop computer, all of you are very familiar to this, and then mid-range servers, and after that mainframe computers and supercomputers. And one topic which we not discussed in our previous example is embedded computers. So this is also a digital computer, and this is embedded because this is embedded within the circuit of the machine, circuits of the, and they are basically used to home appliances such as washing machine, or these are also used in petrol pump to calculate the price of the petrol or diesel. So let us take them one by one. First of all, analog computers. These computers types work with continuous physical quantities, and such as voltage, current, temperature, etc. That is that they take input in the forms of volts, amperes, and Celsius, etc. Analog computers are mostly used in the engineering and scientific applications, and electronic accelerating machine is an example of analog computer. And then digital computers, as the name suggests, digital computers. So analog computer work in the form of continuous data, and digital computer work take discontinuous data, that is data converted into binary form, that is 0 and 1 only. So digital computers are much more faster than analog computers. That is another big difference between analog and digital computers are concerned. So and next is hybrid computers. For hybrid computers, you utilize the best qualities of both the digital and analog computers, and in these computers some calculation takes place in analog manner and the rest of them takes place in digital manner. An example is weather forecasting. Weather forecasting is an example of hybrid computer. Sometimes it is asked in examination what is the example of hybrid computer. So weather forecasting is an example of hybrid computer. Next is types of digital computers. First of all, microcomputer or personal computer. Microcomputer, as the name suggests, are small computers. So these are the normally single processor and single user. There is a single processor in it, and at a time a single user can work on this computer. But this is the general description of our microcomputers, and these are operators are used in educational training, small business application, and playing games. Your computer is also a personal computer, whatever you use. So again, these are personal computers, can again classified into different categories such as mobile or handheld computers. So mobile computers or handheld computers are called handheld because their size are small as of mobile, and but these have basically limited capabilities, so these are not preferred to work, but they are easily portable. Second is portable PCs, bigger than mobile computers, for example laptops. Again, example of portable PCs is laptop. You all of are very aware to this concept. Next is desktop PCs, and last is workstation. Desktop PCs, the computer can fit on the top of the desk, so that's why they are called the desktop PCs. And the workstation, similar to the personal computer, but have greater memory and more extensive mathematical abilities, so that are called the workstations. Next is mainframe computers. Mainframe computers are designed to handle huge volume of data or information. So huge volume of data or information, we use mainframe computer, and these can support more than 100 users at same times. So more than 100 users are can be work on the mainframe computer, and these are very large and expensive. And always remember that different types of different examples of computers, mainframe mini computers, sometimes they will be asked directly in our examination that suppose CDC 6600 is a type of, and there are four options are given: mini computer, mainframe computer, personal or supercomputer, embedded computer. So if you learn all these terms, then there is no problem for you. Otherwise you can feel then you are in trouble while solving that type of questions. Next is supercomputer. As the name says, supercomputer. These computers are most powerful computers among digital computers, and these consist of several processors running together, and some of the supercomputer have the computing capabilities equal to that of the 40,000 microcomputers. So supercomputer have greater calculation speed or computing abilities, and also there is a greater storage capabilities. So example of these are Indian supercomputer is a Param, and then another example of Cray XMP14, CDC205. So these all are the supercomputers. Now our today topic starts here, embedded computers, which is not discussed in our previous example or previous classes. Embedded computers, what are embedded computer? First of all, as the name says, embedded, that is, it is a part of a system, or so that's why they are called the embedded computers. And as far as its definition is concerned, these computers are in the form of tiny chips embedded within the circuitry of the appliances, within the circuitry of the appliances, such as television, washing machine, dishwasher. So these are the part of different home appliances or different types of circuitry appliances, such as television, washing machine, and dishwashers. So these are called the embedded computer because they are the embedded in a part or embedded within a system. So these computers are typically pre-programmed for a specific task, and such attuning to a particular television frequency, keeping accurate time. So first of all, embedded computers are designed to handle only one task or one type of task only. They cannot be used in variety of ways as some other digital computers do. So they are designed to perform only a specific task only, specific type only, as and these all are the part of some home appliances such as washing machine, also television or television embedded computers also used, and so and they perform only a specific task, as in televisions, such as tuning to a particular television frequency, keeping accurate time is an example of embedded computers. So these are all are the part of embedded computers. Next is the secondary storage devices. In our previous example, we already discussed primary storage devices, and there are two different types of primary storage: RAM, that is random access memory, and ROM, that is read only memory. So these are the two different types of memory, primary memory. As far as RAM is concerned, it is a volatile memory. It means data is we can save data temporarily throughout this memory, and after the power switch off the computer system, data is also lost. As far as ROM is concerned, ROM is a permanent memory. Even it is a primary memory, it means it data, it saves data permanently in it, and it is basically used to store the instruction that are very important, or that are used to start to a computer systems. And these types of instructions called the BIOS instructions. So secondary primary memory, as far as concerned, these are the two important memories: random access memory and read-only memory. And now secondary storage devices or secondary memory. So secondary memory is different in terms of primary memory. First of all, it is a non-volatile memory. It means it saves data permanently in it. We can save data permanently, such as hard disk. The hard disk is an example of secondary memory. If we want to save a data permanent to our computer system, then we can use a secondary storage device or a hard disk. There are many examples of secondary storage device. Hard disk is one of them. So if you want to save a file into your computer system permanently, and after 2 or 3 days or after a week, you can easily see that the data is at same place in your computer system. It is because of the secondary storage devices. So secondary storage devices basically saves data permanently into your computer system, and it is a non-volatile memory. There are different types of memory. They are basically belongs to secondary storage devices. They may be optical, they may be semiconductor, or they may be magnetic. But as far as their function is concerned, they save data permanently into our computer system, or they save data permanently. And they are non-volatile. Always they are non-volatile. Always. While RAM, in the case of RAM is a volatile type of memory. So as far as secondary storage and primary storage is concerned, and there are two types of memory: secondary storage and primary storage. Now let us check the block diagram again and again, and you can easily see that the difference between secondary and primary storage. This is the block diagram, and you can easily see that the data goes from secondary to primary. secondary to primary first, and only those data that will be required by the computer system, by CPU. So suppose if you want to play a video song, video song is already saved in our secondary storage. So just double click on it. That means you want to play this song. So after that operation, this data goes to secondary storage, to primary storage, and the work of primary storage is to send this data to CPU. And after the processing of the CPU, CPU return back data to primary storage, and when we save a particular operation, or when we perform a save operation in our computer system, then data is saved into our secondary storage. So you can easily see that both the arrows are in downward direction as well as in upward direction. Downward direction means data goes from secondary storage to primary storage, and upward direction means data goes from primary storage to secondary storage. You can easily see that. This is the diagram here. So as far as difference is concerned, this is non-volatile and this is volatile. It is permanent or it is temporary type of memory. Here primary storage means RAM here. RAM is also called the main memory. Now let us check the definition of secondary storage. So it is possible alternately referred to as external memory. Secondary storage memory is also called as external memory, secondary memory, auxiliary memory, or secondary storage devices. These are the different name of secondary storage. Remember all these terms, because sometimes it may be asked in examination, what is auxiliary memory? So auxiliary memory is nothing but only the secondary storage device. So why does the computer need secondary storage? That is a very important question. It is possible for a computer not to have to use secondary storage dump terminal, also called the dump terminal. However, for most computer uses, secondary storage is required because of the need to permanently store. Because you need to permanently store some data to a computer. Without primary storage, if you were working on a document and power turned off, everything would be lost because primary storage is temporary. However, a computer with secondary storage that saved with the file before the power turned off would be able to recover the last saved version of the file. So overall, we can say that we use secondary storage device to save our data permanently into our computer system. If we use only RAM, that is random access memory, our data is lost when the power supply is gone, power supply is off, or there is no power supply. So if you want to save data permanently into your computer system for future reference, you can use secondary storage devices. So secondary storage devices are used for permanently save data into a computer system. And primary storage, one thing always remember that primary storage have higher storage, have a higher speed as compared to the secondary storage. Next is these the diagram related to different types of secondary memories. Now one question I have in mind here, I told you that hard disk is an example of secondary storage. It doesn't mean that hard disk is only the example of secondary storage. Hard disk is one of them and the most common. So whatever is the storage device you take to save your data permanently are falls in the category of secondary storage. For example, CD and DVD, SD card or memory card is also an example of secondary memory. Pen drive is also an example of secondary memory. These are all are the pen drives, and SSD card is also an example. Hard disk already, floppy disks are outdated, but these are also used for secondary storage. They have limited capabilities, up to 1.4 MB. So they are not used nowadays. Blu-ray disc, this looks like CD, and have greater storage capabilities as compared to CD and DVDs. Magnetic tape, is also used to for data storage. So all these are types of the secondary memory, because they store data permanently in a computer system, and you can save data permanently in this. Hard disk is the essential part of our computer. These are not part CD, DVD, SD card, pen drive. These not are the part essential part of our computer system. So this is a external hard disk. This is external hard disk used work as a pen drive. Now the difference between primary and secondary storage. This is a very important question as far as your exam is concerned. So first of all, if this is asked in your examination, what is the difference between primary storage and secondary storage? Give some comparison. At least 5 points should be there. First of all, as far as the capacity is concerned, primary storage have less capacity as compared to secondary storage. So we can say that primary storage have limited capacity, while secondary storage have extendable capacity. We can extend the capacity of secondary storage as well as secondary storage capacity is much more higher than primary storage. Even in your computer system, if you check that your RAM is of 4 GB up to 4 GB, maybe 2 GB, while secondary storage up to 500 GB or 1 TB. So there is a very big difference between primary storage or secondary storage. And the memory is always in the forms of, you can see, okay, that is another concept. So types of memory unit we will discuss in our next lecture. As far as this topic is concerned, always remember that primary storage is a limited capacity, have limited capacity, while secondary storage have extendable capacity. Second thing, storage of data. So primary storage basically store data temporarily, while secondary storage data store data permanently. And third important difference is that, this is a basic difference, temporary or permanent. Secondary storage data permanently to our computer, in our computer system. That's why we use secondary storage device in our computer system. Primary storage is much more expensive as compared to the secondary storage in terms of memory size. 2 GB primary storage is much more higher than 2 GB secondary storage. So next point is fast data access. Primary memory access data very fast, while secondary storage data access means read or write operation. So there are only two types of operation regarding to memory, whether it is read operation or write operation. So read write operation are very fast in case of primary storage, but read write operation are very slow in case of secondary storage. Next is directly accessible to the CPU. They can be directly accessible to the CPU. CPU can directly use this random access memory, but as far as secondary memory is concerned, content copy to the main memory. It basically send data to the main memory, as we seen in the diagram of block diagram of computer system, before being accessed by CPU. So they cannot be directly accessed by the CPU. That is the biggest advantage. Let us check the diagram or block diagram of computer system. This is so primary storage can directly access the computer system, but secondary storage cannot be directly accessed by the computer system. First of all, data goes from secondary to primary, and then after primary to secondary memory. So this is the basic difference between secondary storage and primary storage. So in overall, we can say that primary storage have limited capacity, secondary memory have extendable capacity. Primary storage store data temporarily, secondary storage permanently, and primary storage is expensive, secondary storage is cheaper than primary memory. Primary storage have fast data access, secondary storage have slow data access. And last point regarding to primary storage is primary storage basically directly accessible to the CPU, and secondary storage content copied to the main memory, means primary memory, before main memory means RAM. before being accessed by the CPU. So first of all, so data will go from secondary memory to RAM, and after then they can be accessed by the CPU. So this is all about secondary storage. In our next session, we will discuss different types of secondary storage, their capabilities, their capacity, and their working style. So keep watching the videos. Thanks for watching this video.